You're listening to the Suave Lover podcast with your hosts, Benjamin Ritter and James Amoreau. SuaveLover.com, advising gentlemen on the art of romance. Now sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode.
It's funny how it's almost like this cut and dry rule. It's like, don't have sex with employees. Even companies have policies against it.
Yeah.
But when you look at statistics, where do people meet their long-term partner, who they get married to, or their long-term relationship? It's all at work.
Well,
it's like 53%, or is it more? I don't know. I forgot the actual number.
Numbers but it's, are high.
Yeah, really high numbers, which is normal because you're with them every day.
Familiarity breeds life.
Years and years and years. You know what? You probably can look at infidelity statistics as well, and that's probably work.
Why do you think Petraeus hooked up with his biographer? They were hanging around all the time.
All the time.
They saw each other all the time. They're like, oh, you like what now?
Oh, and you have negativity at home.
Yeah.
Where are you having fun, great, positive times all the time?
Yeah.
Like every day.
Sure. Sure.
And you go home, and the first thing out of your partner's mouth is...
What the...
Man, negativity.
Yeah, just, yeah, right.
Of course I'm going to go get drinks with my coworkers.
Complain a little bit about home life a little bit. Oh, yeah, you're... Same thing. You can relate to that, can you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh. It's a dangerous situation.
Well, if you do know that familiarity breeds liking and, you know, you're seeing someone that you do like
at the
office.
Proximity. Proximity.
Yeah. Yep. This is one where you go back to that primal instinct of your fear of rejection carries a long-term consequence because you're in a closed social network. You've got to be more careful than when you're at a bar with strangers where anything out of your mouth, your pure id can just come
out. But we're almost just saying kind of that, okay, so this is going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Going to be attracted to someone you work with.
So the only thing there then is make sure that the attraction is mutual.
Okay, but should you act on that attraction?
I wouldn't. And the reason that I wouldn't is because it's too many fucking other human beings on the planet.
But it's hard to turn something down when it is mutual.
Can be.
And it is so available when it's part of your life.
It can be. You know, I spent a lot of years working for a big tech company where there was a lot of travel and there was a lot of turnover.
I have a good comparison. You're done.
Okay. And that company had lots of little side hookups, but you kind of knew. It was really hard to be discreet because you would see lovey-dovey, and 2 months later, you would see hate eyes in these cross-functional
meetings.
And even if you're not actively working with, eventually you're going to see, you're going to run in the hallway. It's going to be, there's a chill in the air. And as far as I'm concerned, it's just really not worth it. Once you have the option to date literally pretty strangers on the street, once you have within you that, I don't know, day game cold approach mentality where it's like everybody I find pretty is at least a viable chatting partner. The stranger on the train is a viable chatting partner. Now, I haven't found myself in a place where it's been low risk and convenient and mutual and all that stuff where I thought it was a better alternative just because of the proximity that could be than meeting a stranger. By the way, for a long time I couldn't. For a long time I just didn't know. I didn't know you could do that.
Once you can meet strangers, work becomes a good time to be away from someone that you're actually
with. I think that's
with.
A big part of it.
And it's also, if you look at it, it's like having sex with your roommate or the person that lives, person that lives next door.
Right.
Seems like a really great idea when you can go outside your door in sweatpants, knock on the door next to you, and have sex and come back home. You know, it's like comfortable, it's easy, you guys live together, you guys get along, you guys understand each other. But then you guys break up, and then you're like, shit, I gotta see this person all the time. They're peering through my peephole. They're sliding notes underneath my door. They know where I live. So it seems like a really great idea when you are attracted to them and they're new.
I think that's where it's the hottest because all of a sudden there's the novelty factor.
So then you're seeing someone at work. They're beautiful. They're sexy. They're cute. And they come on to you.
Yeah.
You quit? Take them on a date? You know? Or do you invite them for a drink and tell them to bring friends because they're a cool person, you get along, and hopefully avoid hooking up with them and meet some of their friends?
How to Start a Kinky Relationship by James Amoreau is the definitive guide to successful alternative romantic relationships. The book has been called 50 Shades of Grey for Real People. Educational, informative, and irreverent, this book has something to offer anyone who is curious and sexually adventurous. Get your copy of How to Start a Kinky Relationship by James Amoureux at Amazon.com or in select bookstores today.
I'm willing to deal with the negative consequences of enjoying a relationship with someone that I work with that is not at a senior level, that is peer or below.
True.
Because I can handle those situations personally. That's my own choice. Even if they were in a senior position and maybe I was tired of my job, I probably would do it anyways. And once it started, I'd be looking for another job. So it's just know what you're getting yourself into and understand the consequences. And how do you handle it at work? No signs, no office sex lunch period, you know, underneath the CEO's desk. Like, you have to keep them completely separate. That's the day job adventure. And that'd be fun for me for the time it lasted. Nightlife, clearly a different story.
I'm trying to think of the last time that I was in the company of enough attractive girls that it was even a question, because mostly work doesn't involve people I'd want to, you know, I don't work in nightlife. But in grad school, there were a lot of hot girls there. And there was like, no, no. I'm not interested, because at some point you're going to be in my Rolodex and you're the kind of person who I'm going to want to have in my LinkedIn profile.
How many people from grad school do you keep in contact with?
Doesn't matter. I went to a grad school where those are the kind of people with 10 years maturation, they're running companies.
Can I say something? The women that I've had sex with are probably more prone to help me out with a favor than the women I have not had sex with.
Probably the case. And the people I went to grad school with are more prone to help me out with a favor than if I would have fucked them and broke their hearts. And that's absolutely empirically true.
Then how do you hold off from breaking someone's heart? But how do you manage a work relationship? You set the standards immediately, but you need to be honest, upfront. Do not cheat on them. By cheating, I mean lying to them.
Yeah.
And just be more open than you've ever been in any sort of relationship, because any sort of negative association or negative, any kind of conflict between the two of you, disagreement, is going to bite you in the ass. You can handle them wanting more, but you being upfront and honest. They will take their mourning period and you will be fine.
Yeah, that's right.
It's hard to stop thinking about nightlife and work relationships.
That's a wonderful skewed perspective. I mean, if you're like a strip club manager, if you're a bartender.
What if every day job was like completely acceptable to get wasted,
right,
to have sex,
right, right,
with everyone,
right,
and have no consequences?
No, it's different. It's like celebrities and entertainment.
It's completely different. And it's those types of things are not acceptable in the day-to-day lifestyle of the 9-to-5-er.
That's right. And it's kind of a shift.
Yo, how many people would feel comfortable going out with their coworkers to the beach afterwards and getting into swimsuits, you know?
Right.
And having cocktails. It would be weird.
Yeah, yeah, right?
Yeah, I understand completely. But then it's like when you do find someone that you want to do that with at work, it's hard to turn down. But I am suggesting you need to keep some sort of reputation and pay a little bit more attention to how you're handling the relationship and how you're treating that person.
If I were to gonna engage this as a work relationship, I don't think I'd treat it differently than any other.
And that's why we haven't had sex, right?
That's the primary reason. It's because you don't drink enough. You handle your booze too well. If I were to do a work thing, I'd treat it like any other thing. Be very direct, set boundaries. It'd just be like any other kind of relationship management thing.
People pick up on things really fast.
It's surprising, yeah. Are you sleeping together? Because I saw that you glanced at each other kind of are you hooking up?
And that's another thing, though, too, is that you need to censor yourself with work relationships. And that's something that you can't just be balls to the wall, because you do have to keep your work reputation. So
yeah, I mean, that's the thing.
A work relationship is sexual.
There's something taboo about it. I mean, sex is not that taboo. Once sex just isn't taboo, then it's sex.
Well, it's just sex. And that's what we're talking about, censoring yourself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you're talking to the guy, though, that decided to get two or three of the girls that he was sleeping with the same job at the same place and think that was a good idea because they'd understand it. I don't think that it was actually fair to them. Later on, because I expect them to have a greater understanding.
Tolerance.
Yeah. But you need to really respect those relationships, because even though you think that they are at a certain level, that everyone's able to handle it because they understand it. It's like, you know, what it is, what it is. You really always need to take people's feelings into account, especially when it comes to work relationships, because it's one thing to go home and be pissed off. It's another thing to have to focus on work and be pissed off. And so if you are in a work relationship, you just need to be very respectful of that person.
You know, actually, I think this might be the first time I've kind of thought of this. I think it's exactly that. It's that emotionality. It's like, I know that when I have any kind of like sexual investment in a girl, even if it's just casual, I'm invested. I think of it as being emotional. I think of it as being sort of like, this will be fun, or this will be exciting, or this will be a frustrating kind of a, this will be one of those fun dysfunctional relationship, whatever it is. But when I'm working, when I'm doing anything for money, I really need clear-headedness.
And to be focused.
Absolutely that. And I don't think that I've really kind of thought about it too much. I've just kind of taken it for granted that, oh, emotional stuff is home stuff. It's social stuff. But that crazy shit that you deal with, the drama of, you know, be with someone or miss someone or wanting to be hot for someone, I probably compartmentalize the hell out of it. Where, like, when I go into work, either I, you know, put on jeans and a shirt or put on a suit or whatever it is, and I go into work, I do work. I, like, go into this work mode where I'll maybe a little bit of my normal sort of snotty kind of sarcastic self, but I'm also really careful not to make off-color innuendos or to say the kind of really free associative shit. I mean, I'm filtered. I don't say the same free associative nonsense that I would say when I'm out with friends or if I'm writing or whatever. I try to filter a little bit. And when I don't filter, I actually don't care for that. I don't care to come across as being this kind of random, loose cannon kind of asshole in the work setting more than anything because I don't think it actually does me any good. I don't think it pays me.
You can't focus.
The work I do is mental work. So when I'm doing mental work, I really kind of need to put my time and energy. And this is part of the reason that I have this, how is my space arranged? And whether I've got someone living here or staying here, whatever, it's like, you got to be gone so that I can get into that mental state that I need to in order to be productive, creative.
So imagine if you're working in an environment with someone that takes up that emotional space.
Oh, fuck, man.
And even if things are going well, it's still distracting.
Totally distracting.
And imagine when things are going bad.
It's all the worst. That's right.
Like, you're really putting your job at risk, not because you're fighting in public, because you're mentally distracted.
Yeah.
And you're really merging those two worlds that you try to keep separate.
I don't think I've really just thought hard about this. I've just been like, okay, well, there's other people and you don't get to do stuff at work. But I think that's probably more than anything, not so much you're going to fuck someone and you're eventually not going to see them anymore. They're not going to like you. But that's fine. That's, you can live with. But the idea of being mentally distracted.
Going into work and being like, shit.
That's not cool. Yeah. Like, work is getting away from the drama, and then home is getting away from the work drama, you know? I think that actually, now that I'm kind of saying it out loud, it's probably because I'm compartmentalizing those things pretty aggressively. But if I knew then what I knew now, I'd probably fuck a bunch of my grad school co-classmates.
It
just doesn't matter. That's the thing.
Later,
it's true.
Down.
That's true. And I would have gotten out of my marriage earlier, you know? I mean, if I would have known then. And I probably wouldn't have gotten married in the first place if I would have known then.
It is funny, though, how when you're around people that see you every day, you can get this level of closeness with them. Mm-hmm. But it's a false sense of closeness. Mm-hmm. Even though you may be attracted to someone or you may understand each other or have certain similarities, you don't actually spend a real time with these people. Work's not real time. Work, like you said, is a facade. It's, you're going to do your job and get paid, no matter how much you think. You don't fully know someone until you're outside of work and they're in their reality with their friends and their environment and their clothes they wear every day. And so it's also smart not to just be invested in someone that you work with every day because you have no idea who they are.
Sure.
And it's going to take, let's say you work with someone for 2 years, you have a crush on them. It'd be idiotic to think that you know them after 2 years. And that's scary because it's very easy to become invested in someone that you think you know. The ideal person that you've developed in your mind.
That's what a crush is so fun about. I mean,
that's what a work crush is.
Crushes allow you to imagine, to project, like you say, to fill in the details with who knows what. And then you don't got to ruin it by actually getting to know that someone is just yet another asshole, another bitch.
But then what happens if you act on your work relationship, your ideal crush?
I understand. That's yeah, a little that can be disappointing.
It can be disappointing, but then it has the after effects of affecting your job. You know, if you know how you are, if you can't deal with those types of things, if you can't focus at work, if you ever had a bad breakup and haven't been able to do anything, you're putting your job in jeopardy.
Yeah, and that's...
And you have to understand that.
That's just do it because you're ready to quit. Do it because you hate your job. Do it because you can handle it. Those are plenty of good reasons. Here's the reason I wouldn't do it. I tend to be a mind worker. I tend to have seen some ugly relationship blowback. So I'd be like, oh, well, you know, I'll go to the social marketplace. I'll stay up on Friday, Saturday, maybe Sunday fun day. Stay out late if I got to do it then. Man.
Sunday fun day has been...
It's been good.
Intense.
Yeah?
Yeah. It's been great.
The Essentials by Benjamin Ritter is your concise manual for life improvement and success with women. The Essentials has been called a straight-to-the-point lesson in the lost art of being a man. Packed with insights, this book will transform the way you think about dating and relationships. Get your copy of The Essentials by Benjamin Ritter at Amazon.com or in select bookstores today.
Though I enjoy my job, I meet higher ups every day.
Sure.
I have a great job, but I don't dress to the nines for it. I wear a shitty button up, shitty pants, roll up my sleeves, shitty shoes. That'd be the way. I would never give that advice to someone that I know. You know? I would like the advice that I know that you need to give to someone is dress to the fucking nines when you go to work because you're gonna meet people on your lunch break. Yeah. You're gonna meet people after work.
Yeah.
Go out after work for a quick drink. Look good. Care about your presentation. That's the number one rule. And it's like, you, when you go to work, you need to be prepared to meet someone that you're going to start having sex with. It may not be people that you're working with, but that's the perception that they're going to have of you at work. And you need to carry that perception on with you after work or during your lunch break. So make sure that you're dressed appropriately.
I think what you just said is the stuff that you can generalize. You can say that to anybody. But
at any time.
At any time, right.
Be presentable, etc. Yeah.
But the crux of it is own your presentation. So make sure that, I mean, I think when you go in, you're not going in looking sloppy. You're just going in such a way that you know that you're put together well enough. Even if you're not dressed to the nines, I think you're presenting yourself in such a way that...
I'm throwing it all in my personality.
But what you're not doing... what you're not doing is like your hair is not unwashed and scrubby.
Clean,
you don't go in dirty.
I mean,
you own your presentation. Brush, yeah. You're very comfortable with the present, which is why I can go in jeans and a t-shirt to a lot of the work that I do because I'm doing work that is jeans and a t-shirt appropriate. But just to be clear, when I get in front of a board, I put on a shirt, I put on a tie. I think the default advice is dress a little better than the room. But in general, don't undermine yourself by failing to pay attention to your appearance. Don't dress wrong. And trust me, I think you can roll up your sleeves and get yourself laid there at work. I think that'll work just fine for you.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Those sick patients in the ICU. Quick question. The people that I work with, a third of the people I know at my day job are all married to each other.
Like, no.
They met each other at work. And so this is interesting. None of them work in the same department. So if you meet somebody and you're in a big enough company and you're in sales and they're in PR or they're in some other area, go for it. Do whatever you want. As long as they're not connected to your boss, so you end up hurting your
big issue would be conflict of interest. You can't be in the same reporting structure because then you can use your influence that way. That's right.
So meet people in that way.
Or
they're friends.
You're right. Go out, go to the office party when you're asked the invitation to go out. When I'm working at my fun job, at my recreational job, I find that, you know, there's a chance to go to a movie or something like that. And then all of a sudden, friends of friends show up who are really fucking pretty. And guess where they don't live and work? They don't live in this neighborhood and they don't work at that job. And so if we like each other, great. And if we don't like each other, well, there's a reputation that I may have to live down, which is fine. But the reputation that I have, that I've cultivated, if people think that I'm heterosexual and I'm having sex with girls, I'm not going to be ashamed, right? So I'm not worried about what they said. It doesn't bother me. At the same time, I'm not actively trying to get some kind of he's a player, he's a man whore. I'm not trying to get a reputation like that either.
Well, less is more at work. Even if you are having sex with someone at work, they're most likely not going to be sharing that with other coworkers.
Nope. Now, if you fuck their friends and all of their friends scream loudly through the walls, then eventually someone might find out.
Or a cubicle, people can see you. They can peer over the walls.
That's why I always get a cubicle with a door on it and a muzzle.
A gag.
That helps.
A bong gag.
That's right.
I do agree with you do have to always second guess who you're going to have sex with just because the value of their friendship unaffected by your sexual relationship, past, history, current, it could be more valuable. When I'm out and I'm with people that I've had sex with before, there are some people that can handle it. There's some people that can't handle it. There are some social circles that get dismantled because of the previous sexual relationship, you know? And so like, if I could be with those people out and have a connection with their social circle as well,
yeah,
like without having sex with them, then it could have been more valuable. And there are a few people that are like that.
So that's cool. You probably handle it better. Without exception, if I'm getting paid, I don't want to fuck. I don't want to taint that because there's no way that I'm going to mix money and fucking.
Sometimes there's a revolving door where you work, though.
That's true. And like nightlife or those deals are where it's very transactional. I suspect it's different because in the sense you're being paid to be in a social group.
And a lot of times as well, those types of nightlife positions, you're surrounded by previous sexual partners, potential sexual partners, sure, future pet, you know, sexual partners.
I'd err on the side of caution and anchor the phrase having sex with coworkers to an office romance, not to living life as a bartender. I mean, the idea fucking a coworker is a little more in the office romance space than...
Yeah, yeah. I agree. Having sex with a coworker in an office space is much different.
Yeah.
Completely different topic than having
sex with a bartender. Well, and however you work, it's amazing to me how much the nightlife industry, the entertainment industry in general, is neglected as an industry because so many fucking people make their living after hours or not hours or whatever.
The rules don't apply.
And the rules are very different.
Very different.
What's sexual harassment at a bar? You work at Hooters. I think your boss
getting pissed off.
I think your boss has to throw you in the back of the fucking car before it's sexual harassment.
It's uninvited sexual harassment.
It's exactly what it is. It's uninvited. That's right.
And you could say all sexual harassment is uninvited. But there's the level of how I act towards someone sexually at work for myself is different because I have different values. But for a variety of people, it's how far can I push this person? Sure. And a lot of times it's pretty fucking far. Like there's very rare to find someone that doesn't promote, like, be sexual towards me, even if they're in a relationship.
Clearly. Well, I had my share of strippers I've dated in the past. And I remember one particular saying, oh, I get into a fight every week. And I say, you mean the cat fight with the girl? She goes, no. I mean, I land punches or get hit by one of the guys, one of the patrons at the bar, at the strip club. I'm like, are you serious? What? She goes, well, imagine you are putting sex and alcohol and money into a fucking boiler room. And it's like sometimes shit.
Makes sense.
And
makes
it just
sense.
Happens. Yeah. You're just in that kind of an environment. You're fostering that energy.
But like the other day, it was like a Sunday afternoon and I went to go hang out at the bar I work at. And one of our new bartenders, like, thought it would be funny to go behind and kiss one of the servers.
You're right. That kind of shit.
And I watched her, and she freaked. Not to him, but internally. Like, she cringed and got really uncomfortable. And I went to him, like, you need to be aware of how you affect people and learn what's acceptable and not for each person. That was unacceptable. Don't do that. And, like, that's why I have certain boundaries and certain values, and I can make jokes and be funny. But my level of physicality with my coworkers is only when it's invited.
Should we call it highly calibrated?
Highly calibrated.
Right, right.
Well, you have to be in that environment. Sure. Yeah, but how do you calibrate?
Well, that's fucking hard, isn't it? I mean, I remember distinctly, I'm not a hugger, I'm not a toucher, I'm not a handsy kind of a person.
Oh, that's weird. When you go to hug someone and they wanted to shake your hand, or they go to shake your hand, or they go to hug you and you just want to shake their hand.
I don't know who I think came from pickup stuff or calibrating stuff. It was an exercise in figuring out how long I could be uncomfortable. Like, put your hand on a girl's shoulder and just leave it there too long until she made you or walked away, whatever. And you learn to calibrate that stuff pretty quick if you're a grown-up. It's amazing what you can get away with because you look at barbacks. Watch a barback navigate through the room and they kind of just intuitively know you can touch the arm, you can touch the back, You can move people, because bar backs clear space all the time. Yeah. They got a rack of dishes and they move people the fuck out of the way. They clear a room. So they know how to get people out of their way without being threatening. But they are actually moving people out of the way. They're not grab-assing at all. And they spend the whole night touching people. Mm-hmm. And so you start paying attention to people who are professionals at handling people. Security guards. Security guards move people en masse and they're not getting a handful of tit. And they know it's because they're aware of it. It's not because they're magically, spontaneously not landing.
You have to be. It's like when I walk through the bar, I'm not back of the hand on the small of the back instead of the front of the hand. You know what I mean? It's like you do certain things that aren't as sexual, even though you're being physical.
That's right. Until you calibrate, until you're getting a little playful responses and then whatever, then you've got all the fun escalation things. But here we're talking about specifically avoiding a lawsuit.
I think automatically you need to have a boundary. I'm social with people, like in slight and small instances, so they still like me and they still think of me as a really funny, fun guy. But I'm at work to work, and then I am out of there. And it's hard when people work full-time, though, and that's the only thing they do.
And that's, I get that a lot. A lot of the coaching I do, and I think we probably are...
Well, we recommend to meet people at work, in a way. Like, you know, expand your social circle from people at work. Use them as a starting point.
Yeah.
You know, use your daily routine as a starting point. When you go out for lunch, meet people, things like that. And, like, don't close yourself off.
Well, there it is. In Chicago...
Go to work naked.
Go to work on the train. So take the CTA or the bus or the metro and...
Take out your earplugs.
And run the risk of interacting with other human beings. Mm-hmm. And I know that the weird guy talking on the train, you don't want to be that guy. Yes, you do. No, you do.
Yep.
You know what's so weird? This is your conversation opener to the pretty girl who does have earplugs in. You tap the ear, like get her attention, tap the ear. She'll take the earplug out. And you're like, you know what's so weird? Like, nobody's talking to anybody. Even now here, I'm pretty sure I'm violating a CTA rule.
I feel
even...
like we're in an elevator 20 on the way to my commute. I keep waiting for the elevator music to start.
Yeah.
There you go. Get her to laugh right there.
Bring it up.
Bring
up the situation.
I have about 30 seconds, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. So you have to get off the train.
Yeah.
Right? Give your time limit.
Yeah.
And then just have a conversation.
Chat.
And she probably is going to take that commute every day.
Yep, and if you like each other, that's great. You'll arrange to see more of each other, and if you don't like
her...
Where do you
get on? Where do you get off? Give me your phone number or whatever, et cetera. And she doesn't work with you, so you can have sex with her.
Until you find out that she's the new employee who you now have a harassment lawsuit coming as a result of merely talking to on the
Interns
train.
Interns are perfect.
That's how it works.
They're out of there in 6 months.
You have been listening to the Suave Lover podcast. Visit suavelover.com to become the kind of man that women crave.